Bismillahir Rahman Rahim. Today we will discuss the drugs which are used for the treatment of amebiasis. And amebiasis, as you know, it's a condition in which there is infection of GIT as well as liver by Entamoeba histolytica. So the learning objective of today's lecture is, first of all, at the end of these lectures, these are mainly two lectures in which we will discuss amebiasis. At the end of these lectures, you will be able to classify the drugs which are used for the treatment of amebiasis or anti-amoebic drugs. Then you will understand the mechanism of action of metronidazole. Then you will be able to enumerate the clinical uses of metronidazole. Then you will be able to describe the adverse effects as well as drug interactions of metronidazole. Metronidazole is the main drug which will be used for the treatment of amebiasis. And in the end, you will be able to write down the drug regimes or different therapies for different phases of amebiasis. So first of all, we will see what is amebiasis. Two morphologically identical but genetically and biochemically distinct species of amoeba infest the body, and these are Entamoeba histolytica and Entamoeba dispar. So it is the inflammation or infection of the body by Entamoeba histolytica and Entamoeba dispar. How this infection occurs: when we take infested food or water, when we drink infested water or we take infested food, the cysts of Entamoeba histolytica, they are taken in the body and passing through the stomach and ileum, they enter into the colon, and here these cysts, they arrive and they hatch into trophozoites. Trophozoites, they are released from the cyst, and these trophozoites are the active form of the disease. They erode the mucosal layer and they come to lie in the submucosa, and here they start multiplying and eroding and leading to ulcer formation over here. And this leads to colitis, amoebic colitis, and symptoms of diarrhea as well as blood stain and mucus stain, frequent small stools which comes with colicky pains. Then from here, from the colonic wall, the infection can enter through the portal circulation to the liver. So main area which is affected is the liver, and this can lead to formation of amoebic liver abscess. And from here, the infection can enter to any area and any organ. Meanwhile, the patient keeps on expelling cyst as well as trophocyte form. Trophocytes, they are not viable outside the body, but cyst, they remain viable for many days. So this is through orofecal route. The infection is through orofecal route. And this can lead to mild to severe colitis when there will be colonic inflammation. This can be acute or this can be chronic. And this leads to amoebic dysentery. The symptoms are of amoebic dysentery. In some instances, these trophozoites, they invade extra intestinal tissues, chiefly the liver, as I told you, where they produce amoebic liver abscess, or they can spread to other systems, leading to systemic disease. Now we'll see what are different anti-amoebic drugs which are used for the treatment of amoebiasis. First of all, classification. In classification, we will see when we have got chemical classification. So chemically, according to chemical structure, nitroimidazoles are the main compounds, which include metronidazole, tinidazole, or nidazole, while other drugs which are dichloroacetamide, this include diloxanide, furoate. Then the third group is halogenated hydroxyquinoline. Halogenated hydroxyquinoline include idoquinol. And chemically, then we have got another group, that is ametine, which includes ametine and dihydroametine. Then we have got quinoline group, remember, this is quinoline, not quinolones, and this include chloroquine, which is an anti-malarial drug. Then as second line choices or second line drugs, we have got antibiotics or antimicrobials, and these include tetracycline, peromycin, and erythromycin, which you have studied, which are protein synthesis inhibitors. Now we come to clinical classification, which is very important, because clinically we should know at which place or at which state of the disease we have to use which drug. So we divide the anti-amoebic drugs into two groups. One is luminal amoebicide, which will act only in the lumen, and the other is tissue amoebicide. When the trophocyte form, they cross the mucous membrane, they break the mucous membrane and come to lie in the tissues, then they will require tissue amoebicide. So in luminal amoebicide, we have got three compounds: diloxanide furoate, idoquinone, peromomycin. I repeat, luminal amoebicide are three in number: diloxanide furoate, idoquinone, and peromomycin. While tissue amoebicide, we have got metronidazole, tinidazole, and ornidazole. These are nitroamoebazoles, metronidazole, tinidazole, and ornidazole. While tissue amoebicide, two other compounds are there. These are dihydroamidine or amidine. These are rather toxic compounds and we use rarely, only in those cases where metronidazole fails. Then we have got chloroquine, which is used only for the disease which is present in the liver. So hepatic liver abscess, we will use chloroquine. Then alternative drugs are there, that is antibiotics like tetracycline and erythromycin. This is a classification according to the appearance of symptoms. When the disease is asymptomatic, patient is a just carrier and passing out the cyst, only one of the luminal amoebicide that is required, and that is diloxanide furoate can be given, or idoquinone, or peromomycin, or any other antimicrobials. Then for mild to moderate intestinal infection, we will require metronidazole and a luminal amoebicide. Why we use a luminal amoebicide when the condition is involving the intestinal wall? Because we want to eradicate the infection from the lumen also. Whenever we treat the tissues by metronidazole, we will add a luminal amoebicide to eradicate this infection from the liver, from the lumen of the intestine. Otherwise, again and again, the trophocyte forms, cysts will hatch, and trophocyte forms, they will invade the mucosa again and again. Then for severe intestinal infection, metronidazole plus any luminal amoebicide, or if metronidazole fails, then dihydroamidine or tetracycline, they can be used. And as I told you, for hepatic amoebiasis, with all this treatment, we will add chloroquine. This is almost same, asymptomatics, dysentery or extraintestinal, or amoebic liver abscess, the condition, and these are the drugs which can be used. This you can see here, to eradicate the infection from this lumen, we will use a luminal amoebicide. And to eradicate it from the tissues, which we will require a tissue amoebicide like metronidazole. But whenever the infection is in the tissue or in the liver or into any other system, we have to add one luminal amoebicide to clear out all this cyst and trophocyte from the intestinal lumen, which can come to infect the colon again and again. Metronidazole is a tissue amoebicide, and which one is the mixed amoebicide having action on the tissue as well as on the colon? Some books write metronidazole as mixed amoebicide, but Kersen describe it as tissue amoebicide because it cannot completely eradicate the infection from the lumen. So what may be the preferred initial drug? The first drug and the very important one which will be used, that is metronidazole. Metronidazole, you must be familiar with Flagyl. Whenever your belly is not well, you must have taken Flagyl. So metronidazole comes with a trade name of Flagyl. What is the mechanism of action? We will see that it enters the anaerobic bacterium, where via the electron transport protein ferredoxin, it is reduced. So metronidazole, when it enters any anaerobic bacteria or anaerobic organism, it will be reduced by electron transport protein ferredoxin, and this reduced part or metabolite is a reactive metabolite, and this will attack the DNA of the organism and will break the DNA into fragments. So I repeat for you that metronidazole, when it enters an anaerobic bacteria or any organism, it is reduced, and this reactive metabolite will attach to the DNA and it will break down the DNA into pieces. So metronidazole is amoebicidal, it is bactericidal, and it is trichomonicidal. Unionized metronidazole is readily taken up by anaerobic organism and cells. Its selectivity for anaerobic bacteria is a result of the ability of these organisms to reduce metronidazole to its active form. So reduction to the active form is necessary for the action of metronidazole. So inside the cell, when it gets reduced, it becomes active and it attacks the DNA and it breaks down the DNA. So electron transport protein necessary for this reaction are found only in anaerobic bacteria. Reduced metronidazole then disrupts DNA helical structure, thereby inhibiting bacterial nucleic acid synthesis and ultimately cell death. Metronidazole is equally effective against dividing as well as non-dividing cells. Now we'll see what is the spectrum effectivity. So metronidazole is not having activity against Entamoeba histolytica. It's not only amoebicidal. It is having activity against anaerobic bacteria also, as well as other anaerobic protozoal parasites. So you have to remember this, that it has got the spectrum against anaerobic bacteria as well as anaerobic protozoal parasite. So it is amoebicidal, trichomonicidal, and bactericidal. The spectrum of activity of metronidazole include the following: anaerobic gram-negative bacilli, and these include bacteroid species, Fusobacterium and Valonella. So Valonella and Fusobacterium and bacteroid species, these are anaerobic gram-negative bacilli. Then metronidazole is having activity against anaerobic gram-positive cocci, that includes Clostridium, Eubacterium, Peptococcus, and Peptostreptococcus. Clostridium, Eubacterium, Peptococcus, and Peptostreptococcus. These are anaerobic gram-positive cocci. Metronidazole is also having activity against H. pylori. You must remember that during the treatment, triple regime, which is used for the treatment of H. pylori-related peptic ulcer, we can use metronidazole. Then it can be used against Entamoeba histolytica, Giardia vaginalis, and Giardia lamblia, and Trichomonas vaginalis. Metronidazole acts primarily against the trophozoite form of Entamoeba histolytica, and has limited activity against encysted form. So it cannot eradicate the cyst from the lumen, so it cannot be called mixed amebocyte because it is having limited activity against the encysted form of the disease, of the organism. Now we'll see what is pharmacokinetics. Preparation of metronidazole are available in oral form, intravenous form, intravaginal preparations are there, and topical preparations are also available. The drug usually is completely and promptly absorbed from the oral intake, and it shows wide distribution except placenta. Metronidazole penetrates well into all body tissues and fluids, including vaginal secretions, seminal fluids, saliva, and breast milk, and there is therapeutic concentration also achieved in cerebrospinal fluids. So it well penetrates throughout the body except the placenta. It is metabolized mainly in the liver. Over 50% of the systemic clearance is from the liver. So intact liver or healthy liver is required when you use metronidazole for the treatment of amebiasis or any other infection. And out of this, after an oral dose, over 75% of the labeled metronidazole is eliminated in the urine, largely as metabolites. Only about 10% is recovered as unchanged drug. So liver is the main site of metabolism, and this accounts for over 50% of the systemic clearance of metronidazole. This you can see, it can cross blood-brain barrier, and therapeutic concentrations, they are achieved in CSF. The drug is drug and its glucuronide metabolites, they are excreted through the kidney. So kidney function should be also normal when we use metronidazole. Then we will come to the therapeutic indication. What are the clinical uses or clinical indications of metronidazole? As I told you that metronidazole is not only used for the treatment of amebiasis. It is used for protozoal infection as well as for anaerobic infections, anaerobic bacterial infection. So first uses protozoal infections that will include amebiasis. So any condition like hepatic infection or intestinal infection or systemic amebiasis that will be treated with metronidazole. So hepatic, intestinal, as well as systemic infection by Entamoeba histolytica that will be treated by metronidazole. Then trichomonal infections, which can be seen in men and women, both they can be treated at the same time with metronidazole. Then for giardiasis, we use metronidazole. Amebiasis, trichomoniasis, and giardiasis. These are protozoal infections. Then for the treatment of susceptible anaerobic bacteria, serious infection they can arise, such as caused by Bacteroid fragilis and other species. Then Clostridium, Fusobacterium, Peptococcus and Peptostreptococcus species, all these susceptible anaerobic bacteria can be well treated with metronidazole. You must be aware of the use of flagyl, small glass yellow colored drips, which are used in surgical wards. Post surgery patients, you must have seen these yellow colored small glass drips which are available, that is of flagyl, and these are used for the treatment of infection against anaerobic bacteria, infection caused by anaerobic bacteria, and to treat that we are using flagyl or metronidazole. Then there is one condition that is called antibiotic induced diarrhea. In this, there is colitis, including mild to moderate cases of pseudomembranous colitis. When we use long-term antibiotics, they are used for a long time. These lead to diarrhea, and this the condition is called pseudomembranous colitis. and the reason or the infecting organism is Clostridium difficile. So to treat the conditions of pseudomembranous colitis or infection by Clostridium difficile, we can use metronidazole. Remember, this is an important question, viva question, as well as your MCQ. That for Clostridium difficile infection or pseudomembranous colitis, metronidazole can be used. Then in mixed aerobic and anaerobic infections, as I told you in surgery ward, we are covering anaerobic infection by using metronidazole, and for aerobic infection concomitantly we administer a proper antibiotic which is appropriate for the treatment of aerobic infection. Then to eradicate H. pylori associated peptic ulcer disease, here as you know that in triple regimes we use metronidazole to eradicate H. pylori infection, which is the causative agent in peptic ulcer disease in more than 80% of the cases. Then for the treatment of bacterial vaginosis mixed infections in metronidazole that can be used for bacterial vaginosis. Then in case of your gum infections or infections which are related to your teeth, you must be knowing that Flagyl is used there. Periodontal infections, we use metronidazole. Then as an adjunct in the treatment of acute necrotizing ulcerative gingivitis, which is caused by spirochetes, fusobacteria or an bacteroid species, you can use metronidazole in acute necrotizing ulcerative gingivitis. Gingivitis, which is because of spirochetes, fusobacteria or bacteroid species. Then in cases of rosacea, topically you can use metronidazole topical preparation for inflammatory papules, pustules and erythema of rosacea. So these are the clinical uses, and I repeat these clinical uses because this is very important university question, that what are the therapeutic indications. Remember, metronidazole is not only used for the treatment of amoebiasis. It is used for the treatment of protozoal infection like amoebiasis, trichomoniasis, giardiasis. Then anaerobic infections like infection due to bacteroid fragilis, Clostridium, Fusobacterium, Peptococcus, Peptostreptococcus. Then antibiotic-induced diarrhea that can be because of Clostridium difficile, and this can lead to pseudomembranous colitis. So you can use metronidazole over here. Mixed anaerobic infection and aerobic infection in combination with other antibiotics, that for the treatment of H. pylori-associated peptic ulcer disease in multi-drug regimes. Then for the treatment of bacterial vaginosis, then periodontal infections, then acute necrotizing ulcerative gingivitis like caused by spirochetes, fusobacteria and bacteroid species. Then for the topical treatment of rosacea. Then what are the adverse effects? You must have taken Flagyl in your life. Do you remember what were the adverse effects? Most of the adverse effects are related to nausea, dry mouth and a metallic taste, as if you have taken some coin. So most common adverse effects which are related to metronidazole include headache, nausea, dry mouth and metallic taste. Sometimes vomiting, diarrhea or abdominal distress can occur, but this is occasional experience. Then sometimes there can be appearance of furry tongue, glossitis and stomatitis can appear during the therapy. Then sometimes CNS related adverse effects appear, and mild dizziness and vertigo, but serious adverse effects which can appear just very rarely, these include encephalopathy, convulsions, incoordination and ataxia. And remember, the appearance of these serious adverse effects warrant discontinuation of metronidazole. Remember, if mild effects related to CNS are there, you can continue the drug, but if encephalitis or convulsions or incoordination appears and the symptoms are aggravating, you need to discontinue, you need to stop metronidazole. Temporarily, sometime reversible neutropenia can appear, which will be reversible when you will discontinue the treatment. So common adverse effects related to metronidazole: nausea, GI disturbance, and metallic taste. So what can be the contraindication? What are the conditions in which you are not going to use metronidazole? These drugs, they should be used for a minimum period, not more than 10 days. So from 7 to 10 days, the treatment is given for amoebic liver abscess or amoebic dysentery. The treatment is from 7 to 10 days, not more than that. They should not be used for more than 10 days. What are the precautions? So if a patient is showing some numbness or paresthesias of the extremities, it means you have to be careful, and it means the CNS adverse effects can appear, serious CNS adverse effect can appear, so you have to withdraw the drug. Then if a person is showing drug sensitivity reactions like urticaria, like flushing or pruritus, that means the patient is allergic to metronidazole, then you have to withdraw. So appearance of numbness or paresthesias leading to CNS adverse effects, then you have to withdraw. And if there is drug hypersensitivity reaction, you have to withdraw that drug. What are the contraindications? If patient is already having some active disease of the CNS, naturally this drug is potentially neurotoxic, so you are not going to use metronidazole. So remember that it should be used with great caution if there is active disease of the CNS. Then dosage of metronidazole should be reduced if there is severe hepatic disease, or if severe hepatic dysfunction is there, you will require to decrease the dosage of metronidazole. So in case of active disease of CNS, you have to use the drug carefully, or you have to withdraw the drug. Or in case of severe hepatic disease, you have to decrease the dosage. Now we'll see what are drug interactions. There are four drug interactions. One is with alcohol. And with alcohol, metronidazole produces disulfiram-like reaction. What are the signs and symptoms? There is abdominal distress, there is nausea, vomiting, flushing, headache, and hypotension. So disulfiram-like reaction can occur if a person takes alcohol with metronidazole, if he drinks alcoholic beverages during or within 3 days after therapy with this drug. So you have to warn the patient, if patient gives history of alcohol intake, that he has to stop the intake of alcohol, otherwise metabolism of alcohol that will be blocked, leading to disulfiram-like reaction. You must be knowing that why, in which way acetaldehyde collection leads to disulfiram-like reaction, and there is abdominal distress, vomiting, flushing, headache, and hypotension. So person has to avoid alcohol. Then what is the next drug interaction? That is lithium toxicity may precipitate CNS signs of lithium toxicity. Lithium is used for bipolar disorder. It is a mood stabilizer. And if metronidazole is used, metronidazole can precipitate CNS side effects of the lithium toxicity. Then cimetidine, third drug, cimetidine, as you know that cimetidine is an enzyme inhibitor. It inhibits cytochrome P450 system in the liver. So metabolism of metronidazole that will be decreased, and this will lead to high plasma level of metronidazole and adverse effect of metronidazole. Then coumarin anticoagulants, metronidazole, can prolong the prothrombin time. It can increase the level of warfarin. So warfarin concentration will increase, leading to prolonged prothrombin time. So drug interactions are four. One is with alcohol, that is disulfiram-like reaction. Then lithium toxicity may precipitate the signs of lithium toxicity in the patient who is taking lithium. Cimetidine can block the metabolism of metronidazole, leading to toxicity of metronidazole. Coumarin anticoagulant or warfarin that can show prolonged prothrombin time. So metronidazole increases the concentration of warfarin. So we have finished the first drug which is used for the treatment of amebiasis, and this was metronidazole. In next lecture, inshallah, we will see what are other drugs which are used for the treatment of amebiasis. Thank you.